Hello and welcome, welcome to Alta Live. I am very excited to see everyone on this Wednesday in January in the middle of a pandemic. If you are here for what is sure to be a fascinating and I suspect very fun conversation with Sam Wasson about Jim Bailey, you're absolutely in the right place. And I am really excited to welcome you. Sam is here to discuss the life and work of Jim Bailey. Describing Bailey as a Judy Garland impersonator, the Judy Garland impersonator, doesn't do him justice in the least, but we're going to get into that. LA-based writer Sam Wasson is the author of several acclaimed works of nonfiction, including Fifth Avenue, 5 a.m., Audrey Hepburn, Breakfast at Tiffany's, and The Dawn of the Modern Woman, Fosse, and most recently, The Big Goodbye, Chinatown and the Last Years of Hollywood. This piece, The Man That Got Away, was his first for Alta and hopefully not his last. We are now all madly in love with him at Alta. Before we get chatting with Sam, a little housekeeping. Alta Live is the digital interview series we do here at Alta Journal. This is Alta. My name is Beth Spotswood. I'm Alta's digital editor. If you're unfamiliar with us, we are an award-winning quarterly magazine focused on California and the West. We do weekly events like this, Alta Live, every Wednesday at 12:30. We host a California book club every month that's hosted by John Freeman. We've got a great website. We have an insanely fabulous quarterly magazine. If you enjoy what you see here today, I do hope that you will check us out on altaonline.com. There is a Q&A button at the bottom of the screen to ask your questions for Sam. We're going to chat for about 30 minutes and get to as many of your questions as possible. This interview will be recorded and posted to altaonline.com later today. We're also going to email you a link, as well as a link to this amazing article, links to Sam's other work, links to anything else we mentioned today. We're going to see a clip of Jim Bailey on the Ed Sullivan Show in a little bit. With that, it's always kind of fun to kick the chat off by everyone letting us know where you are zooming in from today. So I am up here in Novato, California, in Marin County. Sam, welcome. Where are you?
I'm in Laurel Canyon in LA.
Chic.
Yeah.
Laurel Canyon, as we have decided.
Chic. Yeah. No, I'm proud of it and steeped in history too. That's why I moved here.
So cool. So cool. So can you, for those that have, Honolulu, Pennsylvania, Florida, Virginia. Oh, I love that. So welcome. Welcome. San Diego, Utah. Okay. This is great. Welcome everyone. I'm so excited to see all of you here. We're going to have a very SoCal convo today. For those that haven't read the article, Sam, can you give us a very brief, and if possible, intro into Jim Bailey and how the kind of lovely story that you write about in your article of how you discovered him?
Well, it was all my dad's doing. My dad is a huge Judy Garland fan and turned the entire family onto Judy, namely the Carnegie Hall concert. And so that was played around our house constantly. And then one day dad said, piled the family into the car and didn't tell us where we were going. And probably because if he had told us, we wouldn't have gone. And then we turn up at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel down on Hollywood Boulevard and enter the Cinegrill, which is a little club downstairs. And we discovered Jim Bailey. And we were all knocked out. And my dad thought of it probably the way most people would think of a Judy Garland impersonator that they hadn't seen. He thought it was kind of a lark, a joke, kind of a novelty, that this was going to be a little bit kitschy, campy. None of those things were true. It was a towering work of art, and always was every time we saw Bailey after that. So I wanted to write about that revelation, how this great artist took what should have been and what was in the hands of less capable performers, just a sideshow, and turned it into a gesture of real love love, I would think, real love and heart.
Well, with that introduction to Jim Bailey and kind of Sam's connection, I'm going to very indelicately share my screen here and let's take a look at the incredible Jim Bailey. This is on the Ed Sullivan Show in November of 1970. There we go. That was, let me turn off Ed Sullivan. Pretty incredible, I think.
And even it still doesn't do it justice because, you know, when you saw Bailey live, you were, you know, you had the separation that the camera doesn't allow. When you're up that close, you can kind of see where he's, you know, you can see that it's not Judy. But when you're sitting in the audience, and he's completely relaxed, you believe you are seeing Judy. The illusion is much more complete. But still, even said that, the technical ability is so clearly there that I hope people have some small sense of this guy's, I think genius is not too strong a word. Genius, yeah.
Wow. Well, speaking of technical ability, my apologies for muting it in the middle of that. I was like, I don't know what happened. I'm hoping that you can kind of shed some light on why Jim chose Judy Garland. What was his connection to her? I know he also did performed as Barbara Streisand and another of few other celebrities, but what about Judy Garland and Jim? And the pair later became dear friends. What do you think connected him to her?
I think well, first of all, he had the ability, you know, he had the love for her, but it was, I think the thing that Judy had where she gave everything. She loved the audience so much. She needed the audience. I mean, she that was part of her madness too. And I think Jim understood that she was really an ultimate performer. And I don't think you can say the same thing about, you know, Streisand or any of the other people that Bailey inhabited, Mae West, Tallulah Bankhead, you know, to say that they weren't the ultimate performer is not to denigrate them, but Judy's natural habitat was the stage. And for Bailey, you know, that was his natural habitat. So he was telling his own story in a way through Judy with the most clarity and emotion.
Was this, and forgive my ignorance on this, was this considered drag?
I don't know. Bailey always struggled. No. Bailey always struggled to name it And critics, when they wrote about him, always struggled to name it. You know, is this drag? Is this acting? Is this musicianship? Is this art or is this craft? No one really, you know, was settled with the idea. I think Bailey towards, you know, kind of made peace with the idea of illusionist. But I think even that doesn't do justice because illusionist implies a kind of a trick. And there was no, let me shut this off. There was no trick here. It's too deep to be thought of as just merely, you know, a trick.
Actually, someone in the comments says, I hired him for a benefit and became fast friends and ended up being his website manager and close friend until he passed.
Who is that?
This is Tony Bonazzo.
Hi, Tony. Thank you, Tony.
Tony Bonazzo. Great name.
Thank you, Tony.
So when you were 17 years old and in this nightclub in LA with your, what sounds
whole family,
like a really delightful family.
Delightful's one word for it.
You got it right away.
I got it, but I didn't understand. I got it physically, but I didn't understand it. I mean, I got it unconsciously. I didn't get it consciously. I knew that something profound was happening, not just on the stage, but something was happening to me because he was speaking to a part of myself that I didn't know was in my future, which was becoming a historian and becoming a Hollywood historian. And that's what he was doing. That wasn't part of his conscious project, Bailey, but it became clear to me reflecting on why that was so profound for me was because by the function of being so great and bringing back to life this great Hollywood artist, he was telling history. And when you would see Bailey live, you would see him. I write about this in the piece. Another amazing thing that is lost on that footage is that he had the ability to improvise in character. And by that, I don't mean that he would just bring out, you know, the old story, the old Judy stories. He would create new material that was so credible as Judy Garland. It spoke to the completeness of his immersion in this part. And that's what I have to do as a biographer, not create new material, but to join what I can only describe as spirit. And here it gets into a metaphysical thing where I lose hold of myself. But his transformation was so complete that I guess what I'm saying is that it foretold the transformations that I would make in my little writing office privately on the page.
Would you say that this is, first of all, you haven't written a book about Jim Bailey. Are you going to?
I don't think I could write a book about Jim Bailey, but well, I mean, I could. I mean, I feel like I said it in this piece. I feel like I said it. And I wouldn't want to try to say it better, but there is more to say. I mean, there's a lot more to say. Maybe I'll write a follow-up.
I mean, so reading this piece, we will put it in the link. We're going to email it to you. It is an absolute joy to read. And I found myself going down a million YouTube wormholes as I did. One of the things that's really interesting about his appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show, I was born 8 years after that appearance. And I'm sure my understanding of the Ed Sullivan Show is that it was very conservative and kind of Rockwellian Americana. I'm surprised that someone, a performance like Bailey's was so welcomed and celebrated as a gay man dressed as a closeted, I guess at the time, gay man dressed as a woman performing at, not as a joke.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not so shocked by that. And I don't think viewers were so shocked by that. If they were shocked by anything, it was how good he was. But I don't know. I don't think it was a revolutionary. If anything is revolutionary about it, it's the artistry, not the concept of a man in a woman's clothes.
Now, in before she died in 1969, Judy herself became dear friends with Jim Bailey. Can you tell us a little bit about their relationship? And in your article, you allude to some sexual tension.
Yeah, there was a connection between Jim and Judy. They knew each other briefly. Judy loved the act. I write about this in the piece. Judy loved the act. She loved Jim. She took him completely seriously, and she even taught him. And in the course of that relationship, there was a kind of chemistry, I think, coming more from Judy than from Jim. Jim was not out of the closet at this point, but still, even if he were out of the closet, that probably wouldn't stop Judy anyway. But it's amazing to think of what in another universe could have been a love affair between Judy's. That's tantalizing to me.
But she was going through a vulnerable period. And
always was. That was always a vulnerable period.
Oh, that's true. That's true. And you talk about the kind of victim version of Judy and this kind of pillar of strength and of moving forward.
Yeah, I hate the victim story around you. I mean, this has become the Judy legend. Victim of men, victim of drugs, which she was. The part about Louis B. Mayer being, you know, horrible to Judy, you know, this is not really corroborated. He didn't give her pills. Her mother gave her pills. I mean, that has all been written about. Louis B. Mayer idolized Judy. And in fact, Jack Warner was in awe of Louis B. Mayer's awe of Judy, to the extent that Warner said, if she were under contract at Warner's, I would have fired her a long time ago. Judy was a problem. Judy was a problem. But that all being said, we don't go to Judy. We don't watch Judy because of her victimhood, you know? Mm-hmm. She doesn't sing from her victimhood. On that stage, she's not a tragic figure. She uses tragedy. That's definitely inside of her, but she always survives. She always transcends it. I mean, Judy is a story of resurrection every time she walks out on that stage. So I wish the Judy Garland story could be told accurately, which it's not, especially with respect to the alleged exploitation of MGM, which is just not true. And emotionally, with emotional accuracy, which is that she had the strength to do this. And if you listen to the Carnegie Hall concert, you can hear the audience going nuts. You know, it's a religious experience. And I don't think that's too much of a stretch either, because, you know, religion is based upon resurrection and transformation. And that's what she was all about.
Oh my God, Sam, I love your passion. The journey that you are taking us on is fabulous.
I think she's a great artist. And I wish she would be, I always wondered why, you know, she wasn't talked of in the same, you know, she wasn't placed alongside the great jazz vocalists. I don't know. Maybe she is. I don't think she is. You know, you never hear her on the jazz radio station. So she's put over in the Broadway category, but why isn't she not in the Sarah Vaughan, Frank Sinatra category? I don't know. Someone must know the answer to that. I don't know.
Do you feel that Jim Bailey was one of the few people who really kind of understood that strength and complexity? And you speak a little bit about that kind of dying and being resurrected, you know, on stage over and over and over again. And Jim kind of put himself through that each time.
Absolutely.
As well.
Absolutely. That's why it's an emotional experience. You know, that's why it's more than just a gag, or even just technical, you know, a gesture of great technical ability. It is the ability to die and come back to life. That is the giving of all that she did, and that he did. That was what made it so unforgettable. And I think we can safely say unique. I think we don't have to put an asterisk by unique and say, I don't think there's anyone else who did this with the same intensity and commitment. And there's before Jim, and I certainly don't think there's anyone after Jim Bailey. I mean, what RuPaul does is like a fashion show. You know, this is artistry. I keep coming back to that.
Do you think that where did in this ability to transform himself into Judy Garland, even off script, even interacting with the audience, to just completely, you use the word medium in your article.
I agree with that.
Where did that leave him? He was a real guy with his own past and his own childhood and journey and loves. What did turning himself into Judy Garland do to Jim Bailey?
It's a big, again, metaphysical question. If I'm Judy, does that mean I'm not me? Am I living the wrong life? Who are they applauding, me or her? How much credit can I take? And the couple of times that Jim took the makeup off, so to speak, some of which are on YouTube, you know, he did his own numbers as himself. It's not nearly what his Judy was. And he knew that. That was an ongoing struggle. And by the way, Judy had the same version of that, which was, you know, do they really love the real me, or do they love the Judy that they know? You know, to a certain extent, all performers feel that. But with Bailey, it was, you know, it was so much more extreme, that conflict, because it was literalized in becoming someone else.
When you are writing about artists who do something so extraordinarily singular, is someone like Jim Bailey, does he prove a particularly difficult subject? You know, you don't, this kind of very personal piece where you share a family story, you are in the story. It's not a profile of Jim Bailey. It's kind of a really interesting journey of your understanding and relationship with him and thinking about his work and artistry in general, and the way we tell stories and look at other people's lives as stories. Do certain subjects like Jim Bailey prove more difficult or more exciting than, I don't know, if you were going to write about Barbara Streisand or Oprah or Louis B. Mayer?
No, because the question finally is, where does talent come from? And you can never really be certain, but you can sort of get around it. And there is no satisfying explanation for what makes someone merely talented versus what makes someone extraordinarily talented. You know, if we knew that, we could bottle it and then we could all take it. We don't know that. But we can get closer. We don't have to be totally ignorant. And that's part of what the study of biography is about for me, is trying to answer that question to the best of my ability with all my subjects. Where does this thing come from? Where does this power come from? You know, that's the obsession for me. So no, Bailey's neither easier nor harder than anyone else.
Have you always wanted to do biographies to kind of answer these questions?
No. I think unconsciously, yes. The Bailey story kind of proves that in a way, because I felt something of myself here that I didn't quite understand. So consciously, no. It was always going to be to work in the movie business.
Oh, really?
And make movies, yes. And although that's still a part of my life, it's no longer the center of my life.
You're such a great writer. I stick with the writer. It's just magnificent. Everyone here is going to read this if you haven't already. Before we get to audience questions, I have one more for you. Can you tell us a little bit? Judy passed away a year before that Ed Sullivan clip that we watched, and I slightly screwed up. Did he, as he kind of like got older, he developed a relationship either while she was alive or after with her daughter, Liza Minnelli.
Yeah.
And they performed together on stage. Liza was receptive to this. Can you talk a little bit about?
Yes, I'm glad you brought that up. Liza gave, and I write about this in the piece, so you should read that. It's going to tell you better than I can tell you right now. But Liza gave the best review Jim Bailey ever got, and I think the greatest review anyone ever got. She said, "If Bailey stops doing this, I'll never see my mother again." I think that's just the greatest review. And that tells you what art is for and what artists are for. And her love for him. God, I got chills saying that. They performed together, you know, and the review of that performance, I quote a review from that performance. And I've never seen a more ecstatic review of anything. You know, the review is in the piece. I mean, I read a lot of reviews. You know, and this review is ecstatic. And that is because of the emotional overwhelm of seeing daughter singing next to mother who's gone, you know, and that's where it can even be uncomfortable for some people. And it freaked my sister out. You know, she was young. She was a little girl, you know, when my dad took us. My sister, it freaked her out. It's scary to see someone who's not there, totally there. You're seeing, it's like seeing a ghost, you know? So yes, that's a roundabout way of saying Liza loved Jim Bailey. Yeah. Yeah.
Two of them seem to, I mean, God bless them for feeling so open. All right. Question. Brock asks, if Bailey's life were made into a TV movie a la Fosse, who would you like to see cast as Jim Bailey?
Liza Minnelli.
Oh my God.
No, I don't know. I was just being cheeky. I have no idea. Do you know? I don't know.
Who could pull it off? I mean, an unknown, a person that's completely transformed that we don't, you know. Bradley Cooper does not get this one.
Who could do it? I don't know. What a great question.
If you have a casting suggestion for Jim Bailey in the comments,
yeah,
please. Darren Criss would want to pull it off. Okay. Ed asks, how many hours, if you know, do you think the Jim would spend in a day rehearsing? It really appears he's channeling rather than performing.
Right, exactly.
What was his rehearsal process like?
I do not know. How's that for an unsatisfying answer?
Ed?
It's a great question, and I don't know. And you know what? I'm going to ask Steve Campbell, who is Jim's partner and manager, and maybe we can post it on the... wait, Tony says something, the warm-up.
Tony says he only did a warm-up. Well, there you go. I love that Tony Bonazzo is here. This so is so great. I mean, it's so fabulous. He practiced with the band. He did a sound check.
And that was it. God, thank you, Tony.
Title of the biography, and that was it. No. The Jim Bailey story. Ed asks, during Jim's first Judy performance after her death, did he acknowledge her passing on stage? And what did her passing, how did her passing affect him?
Oh, well, it was, you know. Yeah, that was bad.
He kept going.
Yeah, he kept going. Yeah, no, he had more responsibility to keep going. I don't know the answer to that question. I don't know. I wonder if anyone would know that. Maybe Tony knows that.
Tony, you're our backup answer here. Okay, Larry.
Great question.
Keep the questions coming. These are really fun.
Tony doesn't know.
Sam, do you get the goosies each time you watch Jim? I believe that means goosebumps. Larry saw Jim Bailey at the Herbst Theater in SF. It was his last show here. And it was phenomenal. He doesn't have the words. It was extraordinary. How does it make you feel now? You first saw him when you were 17. Now you are a few years later. How does his performance continue to affect you?
It makes me, I mean, yes, I get the goosebumps and it's like watching Judy, but more, because there's another layer to it, which is the tribute, you know, which is what I do as a biographer, tribute. So it's Judy plus, it's awe, you know, it's a lot of awe and confusion, you know, how does this happen? It's what you feel when you behold something, you know, majestic and bigger than life. It's what art should do. It makes you go, wow, you know, I'm glad to be alive right now.
Mary asks, in your article, you called Judy the greatest entertainer ever.
Yeah. I can say that. I would say that. Yeah.
Does any currently living singer inspire that kind of awe in you now? Or performer, or, you know, artist?
No, but which is not to put them down, you know? I mean, when you're talking about Judy Garland, you're talking about, you know, you're comparing someone to Charlie Chaplin. You know, you can't, it's not a fair criteria for comparison, because these are gods. Do we have gods today? I don't think, no way. I don't know. Tony? Tony, do we have gods? I don't think we have gods.
You got to come back and just give us whatever your story is.
I don't think we have gods. We certainly don't see them in the movies. I mean, there are no gods in the movies anymore. That's for sure. In the music business, I don't know so much about the music business, so I couldn't say. But on screen, no. They're all television size.
Oh, yeah. The live performance thing, too, is such a magical kind of an experiential moment, as opposed to the way that most of us are able to view now. Jim asks, of course, there are many Judy impressionists. Are you aware of Connie Champagne, a cisgendered straight female who performs as Judy, singing songs written after Judy died?
No, not aware. Not aware.
Check her out. Connie Champagne.
Yeah. See, I'm not
Judy Garland.
I'm not a groupie of the impressionists. That's part of what made, I'm not knowledgeable about this world. I mean, but I will check that out.
We're getting suggestions for casting. Timothy Chalamet, or
No depth.
Okay, Rami Malek.
Well, that was an impressive
queen. He was impressive, Freddie Mercury.
Yeah, that was an impressive.
Okay, these are great suggestions. I mean, I love considering these. These are fun. Yeah. How did the chronically prickly Barbara Streisand react to Jim's performance of her?
She liked it.
Oh, Barbara liked it. She's tough.
Yeah, that's what I heard. That's what I heard, at least. Yeah.
And there's a picture of the two of them together in the magazine. Please do check it out.
And Tony confirms, yes. That's a yes, Barbara liked it.
Yes.
And the Barbara is also great. I mean, the Barbara is also great. It's not as deep as Judy, but I don't think Barbara's as deep as Judy. But there's a great clip of it online with Carol Burnett, Jim as Barbara doing a duet with Carol Burnett. And it's Happy Days Are Here Again. It's really worth checking out.
All right, last chance for questions, guys. I know they're blowing up. Do you think that part of what you were admiring about the way Bailey went mimicry to empathy, that he really did, he identify with some of what Judy went through? Do you know anything about his childhood?
I know that he had difficult, conservative parents, and it was not a happy childhood, and that's also what you learn when you study artists is that it was never a happy childhood. And Jim is no exception to that. Well, what was the other question that you asked? That was a two-parter, wasn't it?
You got it. Do you know at the time if his performances, I guess especially when she was alive, require permission? Did he have to get a green light from someone legally?
No.
You could just do it?
Yeah.
When was his final performance? What was that like?
I saw him at the Fonda Theater down here in Hollywood, part of his farewell tour. It was great because I'd never seen him in a big house before. I'd only seen him in little clubs. And people were on their, it was great. And sad, like, why is he retiring? You know, don't go.
Why was he retiring?
I don't remember. And I think I wrote it in the piece. I think it was because he was struggling with some personal stuff and some health stuff. And I'm not intending to be cagey. I just legitimately don't remember the exact details and don't want to go on the record and not be certain.
Well, and his final performance was in 2015 and he died 2 years later.
Tony says the demand was also not.
Was not there. I mean, yeah, you know, it
didn't seem that way that night. It seemed people were,
the farewell tour, all the diehards come out.
Yeah.
This has been fascinating. I mean, our takeaways from this, Sam, I don't know if you agree, really thrilled that Tony Bonasso showed up to blanks. This is really fabulous. If we can get some casting suggestions, I'm all for, helping Sam pitch a screenplay treatment. I don't know how we're going to get this made. This has been so fun. Sam, your article is just a real pleasure. We're honored to have it in the magazine. And so you're so fun to work with and talk to. I feel like I could chat with you about Hollywood and showbiz all day.
And thanks to Steve Campbell also, who's Bailey's keeper and manager. And Steve really made this, I called him out of the blue and he really embraced me and let me go free. So,
and he provided a number of the photographs, the kind of personal snapshots that are used in the article as well.
Yeah.
So that's wonderful. Thank you all so much. Join us next week. We're going to take a thrilling departure as we always do. Yes, Christine, we're going to send you a link to Sam's article. We are welcoming Danielle Bergstrom, the founder of Fresno Land, a nonprofit newsroom and think tank that focuses on the needs of Central Valley and Fresno community. So I had no interest in Judy Garland, but they love you, Sam. So you're winning over new Judy Garland fans. So please do join us for that. We will send you a link. We're also going to send you a link to Sam's other work because he's just phenomenal. We are so grateful that you all joined us here today at Alta Live. To you, of course, Sam. We'll see you next time. Stay safe, everyone.
Thank you, Beth. Thank you, everyone. Bye.